you say it. Come on. Oh, Lord, we
good morning to each of you. I want to welcome you to Metropolitan Divine Church located in Jersey City, New Jersey. I'm the Reverend Eli D. Smith, the senior pastor here at this church. And on behalf of the ministers, officers, and members, we're certainly thankful for you being with us. We believe it's not by chance or by accident that you've come to view this sermon for the month of September 2020. And so for this whole month, we're going to be preaching a powerful word, and we're going to ask you to follow us and be with us and pray with us as we begin to try to speak to your heart and to your spirit and to what God has placed in our heart to share. And so at this time, we want to ask you if you would bow your head and pray with us as we begin our service. Let us pray. God, thank you for the day and thank you for what you do and continue to bless us and keep us from night in. Help us to be who you call to. In Jesus' name we pray. I'm so very thankful to be here this month because September for us is an opportunity for us to share with you some powerful, important things. And so,
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please, again, I need you.
in September. And for many of you, as you know, COVID-19 is still going on, and yet God is still moving, and we're still celebrating together, and the church is still trying to move forward. And while we are not always in the physical building, many of those, I'm here this morning to represent the church, Metropolitan Anglican Church in Jersey City. And so we're going to ask you to be with us. I want to just read to you, if you will, out of the Word of God. It comes out of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with verse 51. And you find these words that's written by Paul at a time that we need to hear. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all change. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet shall sound. And they that be risen incorruptible shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when the corruptible shall be put on incorruption, this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass, saying, that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who give us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord as much as lie you, and that your labor may not be in vain. I read for you 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 58. May God add a blessing for the read word. May it sink in the heart and feed us another day. And so we ask you, I want to pray for you now. I know that there are many of you today who are going through your own personal battle or getting ready for the winter to come upon us. COVID-19 is around us. So many persons have died of COVID-19. Others have died of natural death. Like many of you, there are funeral services, family members, and others who died. There are people who lose their job, and there are people who don't have a job, their income. There are people who are just living from day to day. But I want to pray with you that God will speak, because the church needs to be the place in which that life takes on the meaning. By you we pray. Eternal Father God, come now and speak to these who are with us. Feel their heart, mind, and soul, and spirit. Remove the burdens and pains of life. Open the windows of heaven and pour them out a blessing. And then you're there with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We thank God for you again. I want to share with you, before I go into the next selection of a song, I want to share a few things with you, because I don't want to wait to the end of the service, but the Lord has laid upon our hearts that for September, we're having our mortgage burnings event. What that's about is that we have approximately $50,000 mortgage at this church, and we're asking you, I don't think about chance that you are here. I think it's about God divine intervention. I want you to help us to pay off this mortgage. We're going to pay it off in September. And so we have, as I said, $50,000. No gift is too small. No gift is too large. If you don't have anything to give, you would just lift your hand and say, God bless them with somebody to do it. Now, the mortgage is only one aspect of our church. Of course, we have to carry all our tithes and offering. We have to continue to keep it in the building, because we're getting ready to come back into the church. And so we're now trying to prepare, but our first step is the mortgage. And I ask you today, after hearing the words, after hearing the sermon, that you will either go to your phone or go to your app, or you will go in your checkbook and write a check out at the end of the service. They'll tell you how to send your offering, that you will mail it out today, because we want to make a difference. And I believe that God is going to place in your heart to help. And whatever you can do, I want you to know we're eternally grateful. And then I want you to know that you are invited to be with us at the very early date that you can. And whether you can travel across the country to be with us, or whether you can be with us on this kind of avenue, or what you want to call us, please know we want to be there for you. Amen.
Great God, oh, you are great forever.
God, this morning comes at a time in our lives while we are going through so many different things. And so Paul writes this word in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 58. He says these words, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." I want to preach this morning. God just places my heart. I don't know if you've ever had this experience, but there are times in life that the Lord just wakes me up and just put a word inside me, just work with me. And I want to preach this morning from this subject. God needs faithful servants. God needs faithful servants. If ever time in life, if ever a moment in history, if ever a situation that comes our way, this is the moment that God needs faithful servants. I'm not talking about just servants from the pulpit. I'm not just talking about just servants who are trustees or stewards or missionaries or lay council person or Christian education or evangelism. All of those are important and we need them. But God needs you, the average individual, to be faithful servant. And so when Paul writes this to the Corinthian church, you need to understand what he says to them. The Corinthian church was going through their own personal turmoil. Maybe they didn't have a COVID-19. Maybe they were not wearing masks. Maybe they were not wearing gloves. Maybe they were not in their homes and not afraid to come out. But they were going through life up and down. And he wrote to these Christians in particular. He wrote to those who were followers of Jesus. He wrote to those who were hiding out. He wrote to those who was in Corinthian and Rome and throughout all of Asia Minor. He shared with them because that was his job, to reach the downcast and the lost. And he says that God needs faithful servants. And he says that he needs people to work for him and with him. Now, when Paul writes these words, he writes at a challenging time even in his own life, because people at that time did not want to hear from him. The church that he has helped to found did not want to listen to what he had to say. And even some of those people in that church decided that they were going to fight against him, question his authority. You know that whole argument they went through, whether or not he was a disciple, whether he was an apostle, whether or not he was actually saved. The same kind of situation that you and I go through from day to day. People want to know when you start challenging them about how to live and what God wants. They want to know about what authority you have, about who's in it. And so while Paul had to speak to them right there, he didn't talk to them because he was angry with them. He talked to them out of love. He spoke the word of God. He talked about what Jesus had placed in his heart. I can't say it enough that many times we want to talk to people about what we think and how we feel and what's going on with us and what we heard or what we experienced and why we wouldn't accept that, rather than understand that if we're going to be a part of the body of Christ, that God needs faithful servants. Nothing is surpassed that. Nothing goes beyond that. God wants you to be faithful. He wants you to be used and to be blessed by him. God wants you to be an example for him. God wants you to walk the walk and talk the talk and live the life. Now listen, I'm not saying that you're not going to have any problem. I'm not saying that you're not going to have any situation. But you know what? There's a difference between you intentionally living in sin and you sometimes find yourself in a situation that you have to pray your way out of. And so Paul, when he writes to the Corinthian church, he talks to him about what it means to be a faithful servant. That this is not to be done in vain. This is to be done intentionally. This is to be done relentlessly. This is to be done because your life has to reflect the life of Christ. And so Paul shares with us what it means, what it truly means to be faithful servant of God. He says in these words, he shares three things that I want to share with you. I hope the Lord will bless you. These three little simple things that I want to share with you. First thing I want to say to you is that Paul said faithfulness is reasonable and it is difficult. I want you to hear that. To be faithful is reasonable, but it's also difficult. Pastor, what do you mean by that? You listen, you preached and pastored and gone around the country and you travel all over the world, and maybe it's reasonable for you, but you don't understand my situation. Yes, it's reasonable to be faithful, But I didn't say because it's reasonable. It wouldn't be difficult. It wouldn't be hard. It wouldn't be challenging. And so he says to us that our faithfulness to God is a reasonable request that God makes to us. It is for us to live a godly life, to be an example, to call up. God requires us to be faithful if we're to serve him and the church. I can't live two lives. I either have to be faithful or not. And I want you to think I'm saying to you that you're never going to have some problem in your life. I want you to think I'm saying that you're not going to make mistakes, you're not going to fall, you're not going to have a situation that happens. But being faithful is reasonable. And I say it's reasonable from the standpoint of, is that when you understand that you have been tempted and tried by Satan every day of your life, in every situation of your life, you've been tried by Satan on your job, in your home, in your community, everywhere you go. People are testing you, but it's reasonable to be faithful. It's reasonable to be faithful because when you understand that Christ saved you. The moment Paul says that you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, that he forgave you your sin, that you accepted Jesus Christ your personal Savior, that you intend to live a new life and walk from henceforth in his holy way, that's the reasonable part. But that does not excuse the difficult part. But because you're a servant, you understand that you're not in charge. You are a volunteer in God's army. You are an instrument by which God uses. You and I are the person that God calls us to be holy, to walk and live holy. And so that's what it is. I'm remembering ministering to a family who had really given up on each other. The daughters, sons were angry with the parents were angry with the children. Each one felt like that nobody understood what they're. One of the daughters felt that the mother listened to one of the daughters more than did. And she says, I just don't like it. I don't feel valued. I don't feel important. I don't feel that in there. And so she says to me, does God hear everything? Does God know everything? Does God see everything? And I said, yes. And she said, well, what are we supposed to do? Now listen, I didn't say that the parents asked me this question. I said, well, the little kids asked the question. I mean, I remember it as though it was yesterday because it touched me in a way that it had touched me before. And it wasn't just an emotional touch. It was a touch with an anointing to. And as I began to talk to the parents, I began to talk to the mother, talk to children, and each one had their point of view, feeling that they were abandoned. I said, it's reasonable to feel the way you do. It is difficult to understand someone else's position and point. See, being faithful is a 24/7 job. But it doesn't mean that there's no problem with it. It simply means that God called me. I still remember that family when I went to talk to them and began to talk to each one, and I began to try to pour to each one what faithfulness is. Faithfulness is doing what God called you to, even when you didn't agree with what God said. Faithfulness is being able to say that I can't see what you see, and I don't know what you know, but I trust you enough, God, to lay my all on the altar. That's what Paul said. He says to these scriptures that God needs faithful servant. God needs servant who will be faithful, not called to understand. And then secondly, he says to him, faithfulness is an opportunity to grow in the Lord. Do you understand that? Your faithfulness is an opportunity to grow in the Lord. While this life has challenges, difficulty, hard times, you are now in the midst of another situation. For most of us, since March 2020 and to September, we have been locked in, locked down, locked away, not sure what to do. We don't have the comfort we had, go through things, and yet it's an opportunity to grow in the Lord. Your faith has a chance to grow. This is your opportunity to get really into the Word of God. This is your opportunity to get on your knees, to pray and to talk to God. This is your opportunity to reach out to God, to believe that God can change your situation. This is your opportunity to also to look at your household. See, faithfulness is an opportunity. Not only for you to grow, but for everybody, everything in your household to grow. And so faithfulness is a sign of our gratitude also to God for the things He has done in our lives, He's done in our family, in our community, get around us. I can't impress upon you enough. Is that, listen, this is your opportunity to really grow. It's an opportunity not to spend your time complaining about the problem. See, Paul saw the pain, and Paul saw those Christians dying around him in arena. But he said that God is calling you to be faithful, to grow in the Lord, to understand that Jesus did not just die because He didn't have anything else to do. He died that we might live. And as Paul said, to live more abundantly, to live a fuller life. And so our faithfulness is our opportunity to grow in the Lord, in a place that we would not have been, in a place that we have no idea of where we are going to go. He wants us to grow. Most of us read this passage in Scripture, and most of us think about our funeral service. And most of us think about, you hear it, and I know I've done it over 40 years of what I do, funeral ritual, out of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 58. But God gave me a deeper meaning on this passage. God said, I want you to understand that not only it talks about death, but also talking about God needs you and I to be faithful, to be faithful to Him. And then finally, I want to say to you, is that when I say God needs faithful servant, He says, thirdly, there are rewards for being faithful. Do you understand that? Listen, I don't know, and I keep saying this, I don't know how I was selected, appointed, called, sent as the pastor of Metropolitan Ebenezer Church, this gigantic, this wonderful church where people who love the Lord, people who are seeking to be a father. I don't know how. It was not in my imagination. I did not wake up one morning and decide that I was going to be the pastor of this church. I never sought the appointment. I never thought of it. But when you're faithful, there are some rewards in being faithfulness. There are rewards that you don't understand. Listen, those rewards does not just happen by you anonymously receive a check in the mail or that you get a blessing. But reward is more than that. That reward is that you find joy in your life. That reward is your life is blessed not just by you, but by others. Listen, I keep calling you. I know people get upset with me. I know they don't understand what I'm saying to them. That you know, I'm saying it to you. I keep inviting people to come and go to Israel with me. I keep inviting them to come. And most people talk about if they have time to go, if they have money to go, if they feel they can, if they can take that flight on a plane, or they don't know if they can walk the distance, or they don't know if they can get up every morning and go and see the sites where Jesus is, or they want to talk about whether or not they have all the resources, or if they have to get shot. But I'm inviting inviting them because I want them to understand is that God needs faithful servants. God needs people to be faithful to Him. And yet many times the way that God gets our attention is to pull us away from other people and other things. Listen, Paul had been knocked down and blinded and taken to a man he had never known for him to understand the faithfulness that God called him. Paul had to be in a ship that the ship was wrecked. And Paul said that the ship broke up so much that he came in on bits and pieces. But he understood that God still needed him to be faithful. The same is true about you. Whatever in life that you have done is important, is powerful, is necessary. But there are many times that God takes what you have done to make you for who you are. I live in a city that crime is all around. I mean, I live in a city that young people are having all kinds of problems. I live in a city that elderly people are wondering how they're going to make it the next day. I live in a city where about people, some people are afraid to come to church. Some are afraid of COVID-19. Some are afraid because of the community. Some are afraid because they don't know what to do. Everybody has a different answer. And I still say to them, in spite of, God needs faithful servants. Let me come by saying this to you. I know this may not make sense to some of you, but hopefully it will speak to your heart. I was waking up the morning, and as I normally do, I try to spend quality time with God. I try to spend time with God that God can talk to me. I talk to God one-on-one. I don't hold anything back from God. I don't try to pretend that all is well. I've been pastoring for more than 40 years, and one thing I have learned is that all of us are God's children. Some of us sit in a different place, but we're all God's children. And we all have some human weakness or something. And God went with me one morning, and God says, F or F. I said, what? God says, F or F. I started to pray, and God said, and I said to you, you have to decide. Plan for your funeral or plan for your future. That's the F or F. You got to decide. Because if you don't plan for your future, you are planning for your funeral. God needs us to be faithful servants. So whether we come to our funeral or our future, that will determine where our eternity will be. Are you faithful to God? I'm not asking you to ask anybody else. I'm asking you, are you faithful to God? And if you don't know how to be faithful to God, then people say to me, Pastor, I don't know how to. I said to them, when you're faithful, there are some rewards in being faithful. God will protect you beyond measure. Listen, I don't know what September is going to bring for some of you. I don't know the difficulty. No one has the answer to your problem, at least on this side of the journey road. Now, we can offer advice. We can offer input. I mean, I'm amazed at the people who call their friends and family and want to talk about it and this all that. But are we listening to God? And what God says, that if you want rewards of the kingdom, He needs you and I to be faithful servants. It's simple and it's complex. It's simple from the standpoint that you have to decide whether you're going to plan for your funeral or you're going to plan for your future. Just in case you don't know, I'm planning for my future. Because my funeral will take care of itself. And so I pray for you. I pray for you and your family that you will come today and realize that in spite of everything that happened, God still needs faithful servants. Tell yourself that. Would you bow your knees? I pray with you. Eternal Father God, come now and speak and give us a word that only comes to you. Bless these people. Give them, God, the ability to be faithful to you, to be your servant. And then, God, give them reward of being faithful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you again. I want to say to you that at the end of service, we still need your help. We are encouraging those of you who can and will to send your tithes and offering to our church. Listen, we have people who never come to our church who we consider our family members and friends and who are members from afar. And if you don't have any place to send your tithes and offering, Metropolitan Living at Church will be happy to receive it. And if you just need to talk to somebody, you need to write to somebody, if you send a note, I promise you, if I get a letter from you, I'm going to come to you. I promise you, I will do everything in the power that God gives me to answer you. And I will promise you, I will reach back out to you. And I ask that you continue praying for us. God bless you again until we meet. I want to thank you for being a part of our service. Amen. 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 God bless you.
Hey, here we go. Oh, Lord, we need you. You say it. Come on. Oh, Lord, we need you. See you.